stream. He's gotten some pretty, have done some pretty, pretty cool stuff for him so far. This the follower and notification and the matrix one are like my favorite ones that I've done. Adobe After Effects, this, like, yeah. Yep. Because you can render, or you can, once you finish the animation, you can render it into a GIF. Or a media file. Or a video file, which is, for the overlays, it's a video file, and for the notifications, it's, I render it as a GIF. Yeah, it does a bunch of different types, like a bunch of different stuff, and it all depends on, like, and yeah, you can render it different ways, yeah, video, etc., yeah, photos, yeah. Yeah, but for specifically for the notifications, you need to, you have to render it as a GIF. Otherwise, you won't be able to put it in Streamlabs, or Streamlabs won't register it. And then the overlays, you can, since you're putting it in OBS, you can use a video file or a GIF. I use MP4 when I do do it. I usually render it as an MP4, but I can't remember. I've done it before, I just don't do it anymore. I've rendered stuff on stream because my CPU can handle it. It's just I don't do it that much very often because it takes longer. So yeah, Cutlass, that's the Matrix one. That the Matrix one is his I'll be right back. So like while he's going to get something or going to the bathroom or whatever the case, you can put that on and let me go back to it, I'll show you. So this will be, this side will be the chat box, and then these two boxes right here, you can put like you can put gameplay, like whatever game or whatever he's doing, he can put in one box, and then he can put something else in the other, like if a webcam or like just like a cool video for people to watch until he's back or whatever. And that way it kind of keeps the stream audience kind of engaged even still while you're away. It's like if he's playing Street Fighter and he goes away, he can put like he can put like a replay up here, and then he could like put like a tournament replay up he down here or something like that. And then the chat will be here or whatever. The donation one is quicker, is a little bit quicker than my other ones, as far as like the time frame of the animation goes. That's better. Now we're back at the sub notification. And this one, I was just messing around and with lighting and like the crazy thing is you can layer effects too. So like I can even do this, like do the lighting on the face and like have it disappear and then the sub hype wipe in. And then even after that, I can like wipe the sub hide away and be like, fa-fa-fa-fa-fa. Or something, like do another like animation after that, and then I just have to basically just adjust the time frame, the timing, the time of. Oh yeah, and then I just have to adjust the timing of each animation to make it work in the time frame that I have. And most of the time, like all of my notifications, all the notifications aren't longer than 10 seconds. So usually what I do when I go to Streamlabs and I put Streamlabs in there, or put it in Streamlabs, I adjust the timing for the actual alert animation or the alert timing to like 1 second longer than the actual animation itself, notification itself, which works out, I found so far. I just can't wait to finish everything and then give it all to Gavin Anthony and then him put it on stream and like you guys get to see it and see everyone who hasn't been watching my stream, me stream and doing all the stuff. See what their reactions are to all the stuff. And the crazy thing is like I have I have notifications too, and like I have a donation notification for like if someone gives me like $1, like exactly $1, I have like a notification for exactly $5 I have, and then I just have like notifications for like $10 and higher, and then like 50 I think and higher. It's crazy. Good stuff. Good stuff.
Way it gives us a good idea of what we're.
But yeah, this one was pretty cool. I was just like messing around with the spotlight, and messing around with the spotlight, and then I was like, oh, let's make this disappear, and let's see if we can get the text to wipe in, and then I'll make it glow, and yeah, we got it straight, got it working out, so. And Gavin wanted
Hi, this is Kyle
it to
Jensen here
have
at
lights or
Yale.
something on. Yeah, Gavin wanted it to have lights. So I want to try something real quick, and then if it doesn't turn out how I want it, I will change it or just erase it. Oh shoot. Didn't need to do that. Oh, it won't let me. Bum 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 bum. So I wonder if I can. Oh, they let me do that? Let's see. I don't know what this is gonna look like, guys. Oh, sick! Yeah. Yo, that's so sick. Watch this. I'm gonna show you what it looks like without what I just did, right? So this is what it looked like before I added the second spotlight and then added the transformation expression. It's just this. You got the one light comes in and it does that and then that and then it disappears. Okay, so we go back. We add the second spotlight in, right? With the expression on it. See, like the double lights. You're making Gavin looking real, look real nice. So cool. So cool. Oh man, I'm gonna duplicate it again because I want to see what effects it gives. If it even makes it even more cooler. So crazy. GG. Like, I had to make the image a 3D image in order for the spotlights to work and stuff. So, like, I can actually make Gavin Anthony's face turn and stuff too. So essentially it would be like I could like make so I would take this make the spotlights come on later, then I could do like something like turn Gavin Anthony's face like flat and then make it flip down and then shine the lights on it and stuff like that. I could do something like that, but we'll save all the tech for a different time. We can't give Gavin Anthony all the tech. He can't have all the tech. Just a little bit. Thank you. three done. And so pretty much now we got three more to do. And I'm trying to have it everything done by next Friday. So the three notifications, then I got to do another animation on what we got. Follower, donation, sub.
It.
Just gonna create them. So this is, I've got to create a edit my command for my design stuff to show that overlays will be 25 each, and then notifications will be $5. Notification animations will be $5 each. Oh, look who it is. Gavin Anthony. Gavin Anthony showed up to the stream. Can I lurk in peace? Yeah, sure, you can lurk in peace. But really, do you want to lurk in peace, though, after you see these animations? I'm about to get in the shower, get ready for church. Hey, hold up, real quick. Show, real quick, look at this. What you think, bro? Got you some lights. A new way to flow. And this is regulators. Yeah. Damn good too. But you can't be any geek off the street. Gotta be handy with the steel if you know what I mean, earn your keep. Oh yeah. Yeah, man, I've been putting in some work for you, man. Just trying to make your stream as godlike as I can with the skills that I have. I appreciate it, man. I really appreciate it. Yeah, I still got the bits, host and raid notifications to do, and then I gotta animate your put the animation on your ending your outro overlay, which I'm gonna do the outro overlay one now. But yeah, man, I just want to show you those notif show you the notification, that sub notification before you went to take care of business, take shower and stuff. Church. Yeah, man. Praising Jesus, yeah. I hear you. Know what I mean? Yeah. Oh, son. These creative people on Twitch, son, they better watch out, son, because I'm coming through. And I'm coming through, and I'm coming through hard body. Gonna be fixing everything, doing all types of stuff, just learning as I go. And like, I've looked up some stuff and like some videos, and like they really helped and like take some stuff to that next level.
Here at Yale to describe to you for Management 656, the Management of Software Development, this lecture, which is JavaScript and server-side applications. Recall from previous lectures that the client, that is applications running in your web browser, are built on three different web technologies. Those are HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So HTML describes generally what content is in the application. For example, this header, this paragraph, these buttons. CSS describes how the app should look. So for example, this font or this color. And JavaScript describes how the application should behave. So for example, do this when the user clicks or do this when they search. That is, JavaScript is responsible for the behavior of the application. And in this class, we'll use JavaScript to build our server-side applications too. We'll be writing JavaScript on both the client and the server, which is a wonderful thing because there's no context switch. We're not writing Ruby on Rails in the server and JavaScript in the client. We're not writing Python in the server and JavaScript in the client. We're writing JavaScript everywhere. So here in this chart, you see that we have client-side JavaScript on the left-hand side that is handling things like user interactions, fetching data, and altering the page, altering a web page. And on the right-hand side, we have server-side JavaScript, which is responding to HTTP requests that are made by the browser, storing data, and performing business logic. So computation, for example, on user-submitted data or data that users have requested. And the server sends back to the browser or the client HTML, CSS, and other stuff too, like JavaScript images, etc., even data and things of this nature, right? So there's these two domains. There is the client side, which is the client-side application, and JavaScript is running in that environment, handling user behavior, describing how the application behaves for the user. And then there's the server side, which is responding to HTTP requests and sending things to the browser. And on the client side, we'll have JavaScript running in any number of different environments, which are different browsers. So, for example, Safari, Firefox, Chrome, Opera, Internet Explorer. And on the server side, we'll be using Node, which is I think it's safe to say the predominant server-side JavaScript environment. So first, a little bit of history lesson. Where does JavaScript come from, and what is it exactly? JavaScript originated with Netscape in around 1995, 1996, and it was originally called Mocha and was released in 1996, I believe, as a programming language for the browser to make pages interactive, and was not the first of its kind. There were other languages that existed that provided interactivity in the browser. It happened to be the case, though, that JavaScript, which was originally, after it was called Mocha, was called LiveScript, and then perhaps was released as called JavaScript when two was released, I believe. And the programming language JavaScript was copied by Microsoft for Internet Explorer 3 and called JScript. And so because it had, those were the two predominant browsers at the time, because they had standardized upon this single language, it became a standard. It became something that everyone agreed to, and it was called ECMAScript. And ECMAScript now is used in a variety of contexts. And so, for example, on the left-hand side, you see a variety of different browsers.
ECMAScript.
For example, Firefox, Google Chrome, Apple Safari, and their implementation of the ECMAScript standard. So Firefox is at JavaScript 1.8.5, and as you might imagine, Adobe Acrobat is at 1.7. And there's different kinds of flavors of ECMAScript that are implemented by all these different environments here. And there's one in particular that we're going to talk about on the server side, and that is the V8 environment, which was created for Google Chrome. There's a clever fellow named Ryan Dahl who noticed that when he was uploading an image, I believe, to Flickr, that Flickr didn't have any idea how much of the file was left to upload, and thought that that was ridiculous. And it was really due to the nature of programming languages available on servers. So we were writing code in PHP or Java or Python or Ruby, and some of these languages that weren't by their very nature what you would call evented, or didn't have these kinds of properties that would allow people to create wonderful real-time applications. And he knew JavaScript to be a language that would be great on the server side. And recently Google had introduced Google Chrome and created for Google Chrome the V8 JavaScript runtime, which is embedded within the Chrome browser. And that is their particular implementation of ECMAScript. And so this fellow Ryan Dahl created an environment called Node, which runs on top of V8 on the server, which allows JavaScript to run instead of the browser on the server. And by server, I mean on a computer sitting in a cloud somewhere in a giant rack, not your browser. And Node really took off for a variety of reasons. First, it allows developers to write JavaScript both on the client and on the server. And this is super important, right? If you're a startup company, people are your most important and expensive asset. And why would you like to hire a Rails developer, a Python developer, a Java developer, and a JavaScript developer, right? It's much simpler if you can hire a single kind of developer. As well, for your developers who are capable of writing code in multiple languages, there's less of a context switch. And so I think that's the most important thing driving Node's adoption. I think the second that you could say is that Node has some very interesting properties, including its predisposition or ability to create wonderful real-time applications, that is, things like chat or, as we said, file uploads that have progress indicators and things of this nature. And that is because Node is inherently non-blocking or evented. And you can look up online what that means, but the bottom line is that it handles a large number of requests and it isn't stuck handling one request while it's before it can handle another. And so Node has become very popular in a very short amount of time. You can see here Google Trends comparing Ruby on Rails to Node. And this is not to say that Ruby on Rails is any better or worse than Node, only to show you that over a short period of time, Node has become quite popular. And it can be used and will be used in this course to write a server-side web application that responds to HTTP requests. And that is essentially what a server-side application does. So on the client side, JavaScript is controlling how your browser, how the browser responds to user input, how the browser behaves, okay? How the HTML and CSS is manipulated in a response to the user. And it is also in the background, placing HTTP requests to a server. And that server listens for HTTP requests, which we recall is Hypertext Transfer Protocol, and parsing those HTTP requests and sending back responses. And those responses may include HTML, they may include CSS, they may include JavaScript or images or whatnot. And many clients are connected to a single server, and this is obviously called the client-server architecture. So, for example, if you look at the SOM, the Management 656 website, there's many students, there's only a single server, and that server is listening to requests from your browser and responding to those. So what happens when you browse to a website? So for example, here is reddit.com, and when I pulled up Reddit in my browser sends a HTTP request, and this is shown here. So there's a little block of text that forms the core. This is a very minimal HTTP request, And it has a couple different lines. First, it says get, which is a HTTP verb. It says, get me this page, and the page is slash. So if I go back and look at this, you can see it's reddit.com, and it has nothing after it. Slash is the naked domain, essentially. There's no path. And the protocol is HTTP 1.1. There's different HTTP protocols. And accept means that it accepts any content type. So it might accept HTML, it might accept JSON, it might accept an image, and so on and so forth. The browser is not specifying what it will accept. And it accepts different kinds of encoding. So it accepts gzip encoding, which is a compressed type of encoding, or deflate, which is another compressed type of encoding. And it's requesting these data from the host www.reddit.com. Okay, and let's take a look at that in my, we'll look at my computer here and see what that looks like in my browser. I'm going to open up my Chrome JavaScript console and go to this network tab here. Make this a little bit bigger and refresh this page. And what we'll see is a variety of requests that my browser generated. And this first one here is a get request to reddit.com. And you can see here are the request headers. And this is roughly what I showed you in the previous slide, except that there's a little bit more detail here than I showed you. So the request was to get reddit.com. The request method was get. It accepts these kinds of content from the server, these kinds of encoding. So there's three different encodings that it accepts. It accepts this language, accepts English. It prefers English. That's what that Q means. And there's other kinds of things that tell the server how to respond to this request from my browser. And you can see there's many other requests. So when the browser received this response, and here's some response headers, and then there's the response body. And the response body is a bunch of HTML and JavaScript and so on and so forth. And some of these things in here, for example, you see there's links and there's CSS that's included in images. And then the browser proceeds to download those things. So it's downloading Reddit's CSS here. And Reddit has the CSS that is compressed. It's all the spaces have been removed and it's shoved together in one big long string. And then it requests all the images that are on the page. So for example, here we're requesting an image, which is one of these thumbnails on the left-hand side here. And you can see all of the requests that were initiated just by me visiting reddit.com on the left-hand side here. And for each one of these requests, there are headers that were sent to the web server. And then the web server responds with an HTTP response that includes headers and some content. And I can preview all those in my Chrome developer tools. You can preview them using the Safari developer tools, Internet Explorer. There's developer tools available in most modern browsers. So all browsers make HTTP requests. That's what they do. When you visit the New York Times, it makes a request. When you visit Reddit, it makes a request. When you visit Yale, it makes a request. Facebook, doesn't matter what it is. Hair plugs for bald men, which I visit frequently, makes a request. When the server receives this request, it responds with a response, right? So here's the request. When Reddit responds to that request, it sends the following. As I showed you in the Chrome developer tools, there are certain headers that it sends along. So for example, this is HTTP 1.1 protocol, and the response status code is 200. 200 means okay, everything went just fine. There's other status codes like 400, which means that was an invalid request, or 500, which means
that we never see 200 because that means everything's working.
Couldn't find what you were looking for.
We usually only see what the error code when things fail, obviously.
Which means that response is compressed. The content type is HTML. The character set is UTF-8, which means we can send along Chinese language characters and it will display just fine in the browser. It includes the date and all sorts of other things that may be interesting for the browser as it renders the response for the user. And then at the bottom is the response content. And here I've truncated this, but in the case of Reddit, it's a large HTML document. So how do we write a server that responds to HTTP requests? We've established that the role of a server is to listen for HTTP requests and to respond to those. But how do we go about writing one? And that is the topic we will address now. It's easy, and you can do it in a number of languages. So you can write a server in Go, you can write it in Java, Objective-C, Python, Scala, Ruby, C, Perl, whatever. We're gonna write in JavaScript, and we're gonna use Node to write our server applications. So let's write hello world for Node.js, and let's do that in a separate lecture.
Learning Django can help you become a better web developer. You should take online Django courses on Udemy. They've got fresh new courses all taught by expert instructors. You'll learn to create websites with Django, Python, and Bootstrap using Django as a backend.
Hi, this is Kyle Jensen. In this screencast, I'm going to show you how to write a little Hello World HTTP server using Node.js. As we discussed in prior lectures, web servers are a special kind of application that listens for HTTP requests. HTTP requests are generated by browsers, otherwise known as the client, and the server is responsible for responding to HTTP requests with HTTP responses. Node.js is a server-side environment for running JavaScript, or server-side JavaScript runtime, which means that it's JavaScript running on a server instead of in the browser. And it's particularly well-suited to writing network applications that, for example, would respond to requests from browsers or from other computers. And most of the applications you'll see written in Node.js are responding to HTTP requests, which is to say they are web servers or server-side applications. And we're going to write a little one here. I am logged in here to Cloud9. Cloud9 is the IDE, or the integrated development environment, that we'll be using in this class, Yale's Management 656. And the reason we use Cloud9 is that so that we all might have the same development environment, and I don't need to worry if you're using a Mac or using a Windows. And you'll be using this for your project. If you're watching this lecture, it's probably early enough that you have not yet seen Cloud9. There are some tutorials on how to use Cloud9 that you can find on the course website. I'm going to create a new workspace here, and we'll just make it blank, or a custom workspace here, and call it Node Hello World. And you can see that Cloud9 is creating this workspace for me now. Okay, here I'm looking at the Cloud9 editor. It's created a readme.
Oh, wow. This is all on the web.
And we'll call it. Save that.
This is crazy. This is a development environment all on the cloud.
Say my example server .js. Okay. So what we want to do here is write a little bit of JavaScript that listens for HTTP requests and responds to them, HTTP requests being generated by the browser. Just to show you that we're executing regular old JavaScript here, I'll write something silly and say xbos 5 and console.log, let's say x times x. We'll save that file. I hit Control S or Open Apple S there to save. And I'm in this, I have a terminal down here. I'm going to run node my example server. And you can see it prints 25 because of x being equal to
5. Cool.
Printing x times x. I can make this a little bit more explicit here. The result is. There you go, the result is 25. So you can see we're executing JavaScript here. And now we're going to write a little web server. To do that, what we need to do is import Node's HTTP library, which we do through this require statement. So we're going to require HTTP. HTTP is a module that is part of the standard library distributed with Node. So every Node application or Node environment has HTTP. And we're going to create a server variable that holds a server. And we do that using the create server method. You can see Cloud9 is very nice in that it's giving me code completion here, this is called. So I've typed HTTP period, and then Cloud9, the editor, is showing me the methods that are available in the, or the functions that are available in the HTTP module, and I want this create server one. And I'm going to give create server a, create server requires a request listener, as it's called, as it says here, and so I'm going to give it a request listener. And request listener takes a request response, okay? And let's see here. And when we receive a request, we want to write to the header, 200, which means okay. And let's say, hello world. So the server is being created here, stored in this variable called server. The http.createServer method is creating the server. And every time the server receives a request and executes this function, the function gets the request and modifies this response. And it modifies the response by writing status 200 to the header of the HTTP response. 200 means OK. There are other kinds of HTTP responses. 400 means that you submitted a bad request. 500 means there was an error in the server. 404 means I couldn't find anything. And then response.n ends the response and also writes this string hello world to the response. We're going to tell the server to listen on. Well, if you were on your own computer, you would put in a numerical port like 8000 or something like this. And a port is is a numerical distinction that allows different pieces of software to listen to different packets coming to your computer over the network, right? So you have, let's say, a single Wi-Fi connection or a single Ethernet connection. How do you know when electrons come in that connection to whom they should be distributed to what software on your computer, right? So Skype or your browser or whatever it is. And the answer is that those different applications listen on different ports. And our application has to listen to a port too. In the particular case of Cloud9, I know that they have an environment variable set. You don't need to. And the port is 8080. And they would like us to use that port in order to access the machine. And so I'm going to go ahead and put that port number there. And then I think we're set. This should be all that we need to. So I'm going to save that file. This should be our little hello world here. Let's see. So I'm going to run node my example server. And I think we should be able to visit this. Let's see here. Preview with web server. Okay, there we go. So you go to tools, preview with web server, which brings up this URL, node hello world @kaljensen, which is my username on Cloud9, and .c9.io. So you can see that is the server running there, and it says hello world, right? That's it. So we can look at this URL in our regular browser too, and you can see it responds with hello world. Just so you believe me, let's change that. We'll put 3 exclamation points here because we're super excited about our progress. And we'll restart the server. I'm going to hit Control C here to quit that. And then node my example server. And if we reload that here, we should get 3 question marks. We do. And if we reload that here, and what I want to show you is that I'm going to look at the node or the Chrome JavaScript console.
No code on the client.
I'll hit refresh here, and you can see that it places a HTTP request. Okay, so here's the HTTP request, and it says these are the headers that we sent with the request. Okay, there's a cookie because we're at the Cloud9 domain. Cookies are sent along on a domain basis, and this is the response. The response headers have the date, which was automatically added by our Node application, and the response body was "Hello World," which is what we said here. And what I want to show you is that we have access to all sorts of neat stuff here. So in requests, we can do request.headers. I want to print those. Let's do console.log request.headers. And then we'll restart our application here. Again, I'm going to hit Control C in my case. I realize that I'm doing some things on the shell that we're not really explaining to you here, but you don't necessarily need to follow along right now. There's a homework in which you'll be able to do these things without too much use of the shell. I'm going to restart this here, and now when I initiate this request, so I'm going to hit refresh, you can see here in the console that I've logged these headers. Okay, so host, accept, DNT, so on and so forth, user agent, and if you look at the headers that were sent along here, these are the same things, right? These are the request headers that the browser generated, and though that request was accepted by the server, we wrote this little server here, and we have access to those headers. And what the web server does is inspect those headers, it inspects the path. For example,
Nick Darris in the building. Welcome back, homie.
Or whatever.
Happy Saturday to my Excalibur Nick Darris.
That you provide. So for example, search.
I'm learning how to write the server side type of Java called Node, node.js.
Sent along with the request and then generates responses. And that's pretty much all a web server does, right? It's responsible for fielding these requests, performing some business logic on the perhaps drawing data from a database or looking up your user account or deducting from your bank account or whatever it is, and then responding to these HTTP requests. In this case, it's responding with hello world. It might also respond with images, for example.
I wonder if my hosting service that I'm paying for supports Node.
And that is
Node.js. I'm going to go check right now.
Listen to HTTP requests.
Because this is the answer for server-side Java.
And this, for example, is Node.js running in the cloud in just a few lines of code.
You're hanging out with your kid and playing free Elder Scrolls Online. Oh, it's free this weekend. Wow. Good to know. Okay, I'm going to check with my web hosting service to see if it supports Node.js. I'm going to turn the music back up, guys. Alright. It's only $10, huh? Wow. Is that not a subscription MMO? There's no subscription fee? Okay, do I support Node? No! Script Center, Perl modules, PHP. Subbing just gets you cosmetic stuff. Oh, okay, okay. Totally not needed. Gotcha. Oh, I just saw my nephew log on to Elder Scrolls. He got the memo. Free Just Cloud. What is Just Cloud? Is this the equivalent to Cloud9, maybe? Oh, it's just storage. If I get burnt out enough coding today, I might join you guys, yeah? For sure. Who else is playing, Nick? So I have Ruby on Rails, Ruby Gems, PHP Config, PHP pair packages, Perl module script center. Oh man, does my web hosting not support Node.js? Maybe I have to make a Node.js account or a Cloud9 account. You and probably Ashes. No one's up yet. We're all old kids. We're all old or have kids. Yeah. True that. I'm gonna type in Node.js into my web support. There you go, Nick. Downloading The Mummy to watch with your kid. Is this the original Mummy from like 19 or early 2000s? Forgetting. What is App Machine? The hell? I remember I loved that 1999 Mummy. I remember I used to play that movie a lot just to like showcase my surround sound that I had back then. It was a good showcase. That movie was a good tech demo. Yeah, I think I own both those movies, Mummy, Mummy Returns. I love Egyptian themed stuff. Lunch wings are lit. Is that a brand? Lunch wings? Or is that simply having wings during the lunchtime period of the day? What's Cloudflare? Protection. Condoms for websites. Wings during the lunchtime period. Gotcha. Barbecue sauce, buffalo hot, and blue cheese. You have all three types? Oh, no. That's all. That's all the same preparation. It's very generous of them. Four sauces. Good job, company that sold you lunch wings. Thirty boneless wings, two packs of all four types of sauce. Dang, that sounds amazing, bro. I want it now. All right, I think I gotta make a Cloud9 account In order for my ambitions to continue, I need to have a server-side environment that runs JavaScript. I thought I was paying for that already, but no. Nope. So Cloud9, your development environment in the cloud. Cloud9 is a... Excuse me, I have to burp. Cloud-based integrated development environment lets you write, run, and debug your code with just a web browser. That's crazy, dude. It includes a code editor, debugger, and terminal. Cloud9 comes pre-packed with essential tools for popular programming languages, JavaScript, Python, PHP, and more, so you don't need to install files or configure your development machine to start new projects. This is insane. I wish I knew about this earlier. This has to cost money. This has to cost money. Oh, this is Amazon. Oh yeah, didn't even see that Amazon icon. Is this something that like Amazon acquired? Just the whole concept behind it seems brilliant. Development environment all up in the cloud. You can dev all your stuff right from a web browser. I can be in my freaking iPhone and I can be developing my bot. It's pretty nuts. I can be like dropping a deuce and developing a chatbot at the same time. At the bar. Cloud9 also provides a seamless experience for developing serverless applications, allowing you to easily define resources, debug, and switch between local and remote execution of serverless. You can quickly share your development environment with your team. Light a pair program, wow. I used to do paired programming. It was exhilarating to do paired programming. So when you have another developer right sitting at the same desk with you and you are literally writing the code on the same machine together. We got stuff done so quick that way. Might be. They have a large hosting service that, from what I can remember, is a lot bigger than Azure. Oh! Wow, so Azure is Microsoft's baby, and this is Amazon's answer. Oh, snap. Let the competition begin. This seems brilliant, man. All you need is a web browser to do all of your development. The only thing that comes to mind for me that I become concerned with is source control, because I like to use GitHub for source control. Code together in real time. This is incredibly compelling to me right now. I had no idea about this service. A YouTube tutorial brought me here because I'm trying to learn Node.js, which is server-side JavaScript. Did you see Amazon's money-free grocery store idea? No, the only thing I've heard Amazon and grocery related is when they acquired, what was that? Organic grocery store company? Whole Foods. But what's this about money-free grocery store? Go into a physical store. Cameras face track you with what you grab. Scan your palm. It charges your bank after you verify your cart and walk out. Store would only have two employees, a tech and a security guard, to watch for theft. Wow. That's different. I kind of fear that's pushing us more towards an antisocial world. But at the same time, the convenience is attractive. So it seems like our world is moving towards the web and secured repositories for physical resources, which are becoming more and more automated. These warehouses, repositories, whatever. For any of our physical needs, they're going to be secured in this whatever silo, which has automation attached to it that is linked to that website. Pretty much everything is going that way. All right, let me check it out.
4 years ago, we started to wonder, what would shopping look like if you could walk into a store, grab what you want, and just go? What if we could weave the most advanced machine learning, computer vision, and AI into the very fabric of a store?
So I guess it's still social. Wait in line. Never mind.
No lines, no checkouts, no registers. Welcome to Amazon Go.
Wow, okay.
Use the Amazon Go app to enter. Then put away your phone and start shopping. It's really that simple.
This is incredibly ambitious.
Take whatever you like. Anything you pick up is automatically added to your virtual cart. If you change your mind about that cupcake, just put it back. Our technology will update your virtual cart automatically. So, how does it work? We used computer vision, deep learning algorithms, and sensor fusion, much like you'd find in self-driving cars. We call it Just Walk Out technology.
JWOT.
Once you've got everything you want, you can just go. When you leave, our Just Walk Out technology adds up your virtual cart and charges your Amazon account. Your receipt is sent straight to the app, and you can keep going. Amazon Go. No lines, no checkout. No, seriously.
Oh, it's where I am at. I get to try it. Nice. Oh, the perks of being in Seattle. All the nerdgasm stuff's over here. Nice. Thanks for letting me know about that. That's interesting, Nick. There's in the building. All right, so this Cloud 9 stuff seems too good to be true. Like, I'm convinced this costs money. So let's check. Create an account. What happens when I click create an account? Free access for 12 months. So what's the freaking price afterwards? You're not going to tell me? Use of Amazon EC2, Amazon S3, whatever the hell any of these are. Well, let's see what things can end up costing. Let's go to this link that they're not even hyperlinking. And after your 1 month or your 1 year trial, it's $5,000 a week. Months free and always free products. AWS free tier includes offers that expire 12 months following sign up and others that never expire. Pleb Tony says, what if they use that technology on pedophilers and murderers and watch their every step? Hell, maybe that's where the technology came from. If they use that technology on pedophilers What's up, Sleptony? By the way, welcome back to Qtopia. Happy Saturday. Cuddy's working on a Saturday? Man, maybe he's excited about this whole IRL workday stuff. So are you saying, like, use the technology to help keep track of pedophilers and murderers? Murderers? That's a tongue twister. I have yet to see a price tag. That's concerning. They don't want to show me what things end up costing. This always makes me nervous. Hope you enjoyed your free year. Now it is $5 million a day. Damn, dude, that's different than the free that I got used to. Non-expiring offers. Holy crap. All these services, which one does Node.js? Yeah, I mean, the it's all existing tech just used for a different application, yeah. I feel ya. This is a lot to take in. Tons of services on Amazon for web development, server-side web development, for cloud hosting. Let me just make a new account and worry about pricing later. They're kind of ambiguous. It sort of makes me nervous, but I haven't seen a single price tag yet. Oh, here, always free feature. It's let me filter this column. So now everything I'm seeing is always free. That's what I care about. I wonder if being an Amazon Prime member gives me any of those non-free stuff. Who knows? I think this is, I'm assuming this is what I need in order to develop Node.js services. So what Node.js, guys, is, I'm learning about it today. Node.js is a JavaScript language, but It's the server-side language. The client-side is called JavaScript. The server-side is called Node.js. In order to get Node.js working, you need a server running the environment, the Node.js environment. So that's what I'm trying to find right now. I don't want to run this environment on my local box, aka I don't want Twitch to have to go to my local machine in order for my bot to do work. Meaning, if my power goes out, your guy's bot goes out also. I don't want none of that. I want uninterrupted service. So that's why I'm seeking a cloud solution to host the Node.js environment. So that's where I'm at right now. Just want to make sure I'm not buying anything. Code build. Build and test code with continuous scaling. Only pay for the build time you use? What does that even mean? Meaning, no run back. What's up, Delta? Oh, what is up, homie? I can't like prove this, but I'm pretty convinced I'm your biggest fan, bro. You kill me on your streams, and just for that, I'd be doing the world a disservice if I did not shout you out right now. Let me just get the syntax of your name correctly here. I'm typing very carefully. No run backs. at a chat. Dude, I wish I had your gift, bro. I would use that gift all day. I hope you do, because that sounds like such fun to be able to imitate people on this freaking on the T. Uncanny imitations. O underscore O. I think that's right. Oops. I forgot the out part. No run backs at a chat. Oh man. Okay, I got it right. Cool. Hey guys, definitely give Delta Red a follow. One of the most entertaining Street Fighter streams you'll ever see. Promise. I'm doing good, man. I'm just trying to learn some JavaScript. So that will help me learn how to make a Twitch bot. That's the ultimate goal here, is I want to try to make my own Twitch bot from scratch. I have a programming background, but it's only in C++, and C#. So when I go to the Twitch developer portal, they give you all these samples on how to do their stuff in languages I'm not familiar with. Like JavaScript, PHP, Ruby, Node. I'm like, what is all these? What are all these languages? No run back. Yeah, I want to make my own Twitch bot, so I have to learn a bunch of stuff in order to do that. Hey, dude. Hey, Delta. What if, bro? And just humor me, bro. What if Wolfcrone was like the sickest computer programmer out there? Like, worldwide acclaim. He's just really humble about it. He's for some reason humble about that, but Street Fighter, he's, you know, different story, obviously. But as a world-class Nobel Prize-winning computer science programmer, hella low-key, wouldn't that be a trip? Damn, Wolfcrone, I had no idea, bro. Wow, you never talked about that dimension of your life. How you doing, by the way? I don't even think I asked you how you're doing, man. How's life, Delta Red, in the building? Nobel Prize Turing Award. Hey, what's up, Roby? Roby Expert, is that a play on the word Ruby? The Ruby programming language? Or am I completely off there and it means something like puppies rock? Welcome to Qtopia, guys. You guys are both first-time Qtopians to my stream, so hope you enjoy your stay here. That would be hilarious. Like, wow, damn, Wolf Crone, you never told me about that, bro. You know how to code? Damn, son. And yeah, I know how to. I didn't tell you. I can't do it like you, bro. Just a random name. Gotcha. So how did you stumble on my stream, Roby Expert? I'm new to this IRL stuff, so I am becoming curious whenever I see a new face. Like, what brought you here? Get started with AWS. Looking for someone doing math or program. Wow. Well, you've come to a place where someone's trying to do programming. Does that count? I'm not familiar with Java, but I'm trying to learn Java. Oh wait, does this just use my Amazon? C trigger in the building. How's my art taste? Shout out my boy too. Yo! Yo, C-Trigger with the resub! Damn, homie, 6 months in a row, really. Much love to you, bro. I really, really appreciate it. I'm gonna keep working hard for you guys, man. I am dedicated to being a full-time Twitcher. No matter what it takes, I'm gonna be full-time Twitcher. And part of that ambition is to even stream my work days. That was my latest decision as of last week. I'm not only gonna stream my my gameplay of whatever games, I'm streaming my work day. Thank you so much, man. I hope you continue to enjoy the Bruce Lee Kappa emote. Bruce Lee in the building, Kappa in the building. Bruce Lee invented Kappa before the Kappa vase even existed. Ooh, with a trailing H even, the lowercase trailing H to imply fade out. Fade, 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 fade. And then the fade out. You're a pro, C-Trigger. Thanks again, man. And Delta Red says, I'm doing well. Thanks for asking. Glad to hear it, man. You love Java with milk and sugar? This is exactly the Java I'm trying to do. That type of Java, C-Trigger. I should do this off stream, right, guys? So you guys don't know like where to find my house and egg it. I don't need my house egged unless you guys were. I don't know if you guys were planning to do that or not. Phone number, blah blah blah. Blah blah blah. Blah blah blah. Blah blah. Address, blah 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 blah. I need a credit card? Uh-oh. I don't have a credit card. Please type your payment information so we can verify your identity. We will not charge you unless you usage exceeds. Oh, they need a credit card in order for my usage to, in order my usage goes crazy, they can have me by the balls. Oh no! Don't you ever rub your nuts on my drum set, Nick. Don't you ever! What do I need AWS for? I'm trying to get AWS in order to run node.js stuff. So server-side JavaScript. I need some I need a node.js environment to run that server-side JavaScript stuff. For my bot to be happy. How to Java, so in order to learn how to Java, you add a chat. I like how you throw in some of his E-League speak. Who gives a If Crone was a tutor, oh, Lord help the tutoree. The tutoree? Is that even a thing? So, hey, little guy, come here, little man, let me teach you at, Oh, trust me, I don't sound like him. I'm just going off what I hear from Delta Red. You gotta check out his channel, bro. There it is, since you just got here, C-Trig. And C-Trigger with them creative streams, bro. You guys definitely gotta check out C-Trigger, too. Oh, man. I don't have a credit card, so I can't continue and make this account. That sucks. Where else can I host Node.js? I guess I can host it on my own box for now. That'll be a pain because I gotta set up the environment and all that stuff. Do I want to do that? You know what? I'm gonna ask my web hosting service right now. Because I pay for web hosting, but I'm not certain if my web hosting service supports node.js. This is a new territory for me. Alright, so here's my web hosting. I always get ripped apart for using Bing. The only reason why I use Bing C-Trigger is because it gives me rewards for searching. So like, I can, after a month's worth of searching, I get like a $5 Amazon gift card or something silly like that. Google doesn't give me rewards, bro. So that means Bing is the superior search engine, because it gives me stuff. Superior in its algorithms and everything. Node.js. Oh, what? Google has a... I didn't even think of Google. Oh, come on, Google. Don't ask me for a credit card, Google. I ain't want to give you no credit card. I just want to write code. Node.js on Google Cloud platform. Try it free. It's funny, the article I was reading didn't even mention Google. Google is sort of a thing. Try cloud platform for free. Hella read all of these. Oh, look at this. This is exactly... Look at this bullet... They're speaking directly to Amazon with this bullet point right here that I'm highlighting. No auto charge after free trial ends. That is what stopped me dead in my tracks when I was signing up for the Amazon Cloud 9 service. So I canceled that and let's try to do this. Oh, never mind. I take it back. I didn't read it. I'm an idiot. They asked for a credit card also. Dang it. I can add a bank account? Oops. Let's see. Excuse me. Thank you. Thank you, Delta Ray. Okay. So at least the Google one gives me the option of providing bank info, which I can. I have that available. I don't have a credit card, but I have bank info I can give them. So that'll work. So I'm trying that right now. Just making sure I do it off screen, obviously.
La 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 la.
Alright, we're in. We are in, finally. So, Google Cloud. Google Cloud hooked us up. We've given you $300 in free trial credit to spend. What? Oh, this is my cut right here. Alright, so I'm running completely blind now. So we have BigQuery, Google Cloud, SQL, Google Cloud Storage, Google Cloud Storage, JSON, Stackdriver logging. Where's Node.js? Node.js, that's all I want! Oh, I attende la bella pace. Sequel. This is crazy, man. All the services available. Oh, I think this is it right here. Yo, what's up, Chills McPhee? How are you, man? Welcome back to Keytopia. Happy Saturday. How is big bro Chills McPhee doing today? Over here, I'm just trying to learn more JavaScript. Today in particular, I'm trying to learn what's called Node.js. That's JavaScript for server-side programming. So I'm going to need to learn server-side programming in order to get my bot working. I want my bot running on a server as opposed to running on my local PC. So say I'm streaming, my bot's doing work, and then the power goes out on the machine the bot's running, then the bot stops working. So we want this uninterruptible service that the bot sits on. So that's why I'm trying to learn this stuff. Server-side programming. I know when you get it to work, you'll be so happy. Dude, I'm gonna blast all the hype horns in the galaxy once it starts to work. Then I'll be like in every Twitch channel. Look guys, look, it's a bot. No one cares, Cutlass. Oh man. Look guys, look. Oh, here we go. This has got to be it. Bam. Oh, it's the same thing. Utopia is the name of my bot. Got any plans for the weekend, Chills McPhee? Or are you just gonna Chills McPhee this weekend? You've successfully set up your project and created the service account. Oh, really? I'm feeling kind of fancy, guys. Next, download the private key you'll use to authenticate your service account. Okay. Store this file securely, as anyone with this key can act as the service account to access your GCP, Google Cloud platform resources. All right, you guys aren't going to use my key, right? Oh wait, I had to email myself that account real quick. Private key. Sending myself an email real quick. Keep track of that key. Send. Done. Okay, cool. I'm gonna lose some points this weekend? That's what's up, homie. It's all about charity, right? We're giving points away. We're giving away points to the needy, all in the name of training and becoming better players. Aw, yeah! Oh wow, this is my key. Alright, you guys got this? Got it all memorized? Cool. Okay. All right. Utopia project name. I guess I need to enable. Welcome. All right, welcome to App Engine, a powerful platform to build web and mobile apps that scale automatically. Your first app. Learn how to build and deploy an App Engine with a simple Hello World app. If you're new to App Engine, then start here. I sure am new, and I want to do Node.js. In which region would you like to serve your app? Your app will be served from the selected region anywhere. You can use your app, but users closer to the selected region will have lower latency. Wow. So I'm actually making geographic decisions with my app right here. Where do I want my server to be? Where do I want my server to reside on? So the closest we can get is North America, Central US. US Central. We can host it in Australia if we want. We might get more latency though. All right, we'll do US. Oh no, not US East. US Central. They got no US West Coast? Racist. Racist. All right, US Central is the closest we get to US West Coast. That's fine. Go next. I swear, if you ask me for billing again, I thought I already did this. Son of a, I thought I already made one. Okay, another obstacle. I have to wait for my billing account to be activated, which will take a couple days. That sucks, dude. So I think for now, we'll try to just make our own Node.js environment. I was trying to use a cloud, but cloud is being real pain because all the cloud services need billing, no matter which one I try, it seems. So we're gonna fall back to YouTube and see how to make our own very own Node.js environment. Node.js for beginners, installing on Windows. Yes, let's do that. Let's install this on Windows.
Make the smart choice this season with Unlimited from Sprint. Get 4 lines of Unlimited for $25 per month per line, and we'll give you a 5th line free. That's 50% off Verizon, AT&T, and T-Mobile. Happy holidays from Sprint.
Welcome, everybody, to the greatest Node.js tutorials that have ever been made. My name is Bucky Roberts, and in this video series, I'm going to be teaching you guys everything you need to know about Node.js. Now, if you're watching this video series, I'm going to assume that you guys have heard of Node.js before, but you may not know exactly what it is.
Showing that Christmas spirit, drinking eggnog out of chat.
Stuff for the internet, but I don't know, maybe you went to your website,
no rum,
started
bad.
Trying to figure out what it was, and you saw this.
So what's this website?
Scalable applications. It's
Chrome's Java.
Alright, that's confusing. Let me just go and see if I can see what these examples are. Oh, yeah, look at this. Now everything makes sense to me. So, again, going to the website and starting, you know, trying to read everything, they don't really do
Node.js.org. Oh, okay.
This thing is for a complete beginner. So let me put it in a really simple...
Let me pause and go get this website up. Node.js.org. Okay, I'm gonna keep this in mind. We'll download this eventually.
Node.js is a way that you can make really cool server-side applications. And that means that if you want to make, let's say, a website or a chat program or a
chat program,
or even like a social network, any web application that you can use to actually connect people, Node.js is an awesome choice. Now, if you guys are like, all right, you know what? I already know PHP, for example. Sounds like it can do all of those things, so I'll see you later. Maybe I'll catch you in another tutorial series. Well,
I've used a little PHP.
The reason that Node.js is becoming so popular, for one reason, is because it's awesome for real-time stuff. For example, if you were to make a chat application, and of course you would want to be updated in real time, well, PHP isn't that great for those kinds of applications. It's kind of slow and it uses a lot of memory resources and it has a bunch of drawbacks. And again, to explain all of the benefits of Node.js, I'm gonna have to show you guys some examples. So the first thing we should do is install this bad boy. So in this video, I'll show you guys how to install it for Windows. In the next video, I'll show you how to install it for a Mac. So again, you guys are probably
Windows, please.
Out. Might as well just click this big green install button to get started. And this is going to give you an MSI file, which is essentially just a wizard, and it's really easy to install actually. So wait till that gets done, double click it, and do you trust it? Okay, I trust it. Actually, let me minimize out of this. All right, so right here you pretty much just want to keep all the defaults. Next, let me read through this. Okay, I definitely read all that. Next, it's going to install it in the default location. Do not change this, please. Make sure that it's right in your program files. Next, everything looks good. Next, install. Do we give it permission to? Yes, of course we do. Dun, 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 dun,
dun, dun. Yes, yes, format my hard drive. Nope, no problem.
Easy is that. Let's go ahead and finish this. And now what do we do? I mean, how do we know for sure that it actually installed? Well, the first and probably the easiest test that you can do is you can actually go to your command line by, if you go to your start menu, and then you can either search for or just type cmd, and that will pretty much open up the command prompt. So what it did whenever it installed it is it set up a system path, so now we can actually run it by just typing the word node. And just to test, again, I know that I'm not explaining the syntax or anything. This is pretty much just to test and make sure that everything is installed properly. But if you type console.log, and inside here you just type something like, I don't know, just type anything you want, bacon. What this means, again, is just print some text out to the console, or in other words, this terminal. So again, don't really worry about the syntax. Just copy this, make sure everything is working. If it's not, then go back and make sure that you kept all the defaults whenever you installed it. But if you see the word bacon, undefined, then you're good to go. So, of course, what we can do is we can type a bunch of Node.js in this awesome looking, you know, command prompt. But fortunately, they have programs that are a little bit, you know, more aesthetically pleasing than this thing that looks like it was developed in 1940. So, first of all, I want to mention that I am a big fan of free IDEs and pretty much software that you can develop Node.js in. However, for this tutorial series, I'm going to be using a JetBrains IDE to type all my code, and I highly, highly, highly recommend it.
Sponsored.
If you actually buy this, then it is, let's see, $50. But guys, trust me.
Sponsored.
If you guys want to download this IDE, it is hands down the best platform for developing Node.js applications. And I know that everyone has their personal preference. You know, some people like potatoes, some people don't, whatever. But this is not a competition. This is the best. And another thing is for students, or if you're just teaching it or even using it for an open source project, it's completely free. So guys, splooge on this. I know it's $50, like I said, but it's well worth it. If you gotta steal some money from your grandma or anything, then that is fine. So download this. Again, if you want to try it free for 30 days, do that. And actually, I don't have this exact IDE installed on my computer. I actually have another IDE from this company, but they're pretty much the exact same thing. Mine is called IntelliJ, but again, if you install it, you're going to see that it's pretty much the same thing. This IDE is more geared towards Java development, but I'm going to show you guys how to install a plugin, and it's pretty much going to give you the exact same functionality as WebStorm. So the first thing we want to do whenever we have our IDE installed is create a new project. So go here, and what we want to choose from here is just a static web application. This is just a blank web application, nothing fancy. It's pretty much like the most basic project that you can make. So I'm going to click next, and from here, again, just choose wherever you want to save it. I am going to save mine in a Node.js file that I already made before this little tutorial. And I'm just going to name my project like Bucky. So I want it to be named Bucky. I'm going to save it in a directory. Bucky looks good. Finish. Do I want to create it? Yes, I do. And check this out. All right. Right now, we just have a directory called Bucky, which is our main directory, and this folder right here is pretty much just all the settings for JetBrains, your IDE, like your preferences and stuff. We actually never are going to edit anything in here, and this is just a file that references, these are pretty much just JetBrains files that came with your IDE, nothing to do with Node.js, so don't worry about these or ever worry about touching them. So we pretty much have a blank project, a blank folder with nothing in it. So the first thing, of course, we need to do is create some kind of file. Well, if we right click our main project, we can select new JavaScript file and name this file app.js. So this is going to be our starting point. In other words, whenever we start making Node.js applications, our program is going to look to this file first, and whatever coded is in here, it's gonna run. So it's like our main file, simple enough. So if I just wanna, actually we'll just do this. So console.log, so just like before, we can type bacon, and if we either right click and run this, check out what happens. So we pretty much have the exact same thing as the command line. However, as you can see, this little environment is a little bit cleaner and gives us a few more tools than.
Yo, Fi, welcome back. How are you, Fi?
So,
happy Saturday to you, man.
That is set up and running perfectly. However, there are a few things that I want to take care of.
I'm just streaming my work day these days. I decided, as part of my Twitch career, I'm going to stream my entire work day. So, here you guys go.
Websites most of the time, instead of, you know, just having the user use a terminal or command prompt. So what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to go up to this little drop-down menu in the top right.
And I'm doing well, man. I'm pretty excited to try these IRL streams.
How do you want to set up your program to run?
Because it kind of merges my two passions with, which is streaming, and my other passion was like programming. Before, I used to do those two things separately in my life, but merging them is making me happy because I don't have to ever decide between the two now. I'll always be streaming myself program and working, so. Aside from the games, obviously, that I stream, like Street Fighter. So I'm stoked.
Open it up in an actual website, and of course, you can't just open it in Chrome. You need to give it a website to open, so I'll put HTTP. Localhost, which means my computer, port 8888. So again, whenever we're making Node.js applications, we're gonna have to say that this is the correct port in the correct location, but we'll take care of that whenever I show you guys how to do everything. Just setting everything up now. So just hit apply, okay, and if we run this right now, then it's not gonna open in Chrome, and that's because we're not giving it any code to open in Chrome right now, because all this says is print some text out to the terminal, which is this. So I know it's kind of confusing, but you guys are going to see later on whenever we start making actual Node.js apps that it actually makes sense. So one other thing that I want to explain is this. Eventually, when you start typing actual Node.js, you're going to get some warnings from your IDE. So in order to get rid of those warnings, we need to tell IntelliJ, or actually think if you're using WebStorm, then everything is going to run fine. But if you're using another IDE from JetBrains, then this is what you do. You need to go to File, Settings, and first of all, you need to install the Node.js plugin. So like I said, this WebStorm right here, if I actually just click it, it's already set up for Node.js. However, if you have, I don't know, another product like IntelliJ, this is mostly, as you can see, for Java. However, you can tweak it to pretty much use with Node.js. So this is how you do that. You go to the plugins.
Okay, I'm gonna give this a little try. Just try to get the bare bones working. So I'm gonna go to the Node.js website, which is right here. Turn my music back on. We'll turn it back up, I should say. Here we go, turning my music back up. Okay. So here's the website for Node.js. Node.js.org. We want to download recommended version for Windows. Pops up the MSI file. We'll launch the MSI. So we're going to install Node.js on my PC. Program files, Node.js. All the defaults. Alright, so Node.js is successfully installed, so what I'm going to do now is open up a command prompt and try to verify if it's working in my command prompt environment. So I'm just going to simply type in Node. Oh, and that works. So let's try to write some Java code console. Wait, document.write. Hello, Qtopia. Document is not defined. Console.log is what we want. Console.log. Let's try it. So console.log, single quotations, hello, Qtopia, single quote, alright, it works. So we have Node.js installed on our local environment. After much headache trying to get Node.js cloud hosting accounts on Amazon and Google, because they wanted a credit card, and I don't have one. So we just instead decided to install Node.js on my local machine for now. So now we can at least get some code running, but at this point I'm already tired. I spent how many hours trying to get this up and running? Let's see. 2 hours. That's all my brain can take on this fine Saturday. So I think I might play some Forza or something. Yo, Kunimitsu in the building. How is Kuni doing today? Welcome back to Keytopia. Or should I play Street Fighter? I'll play Street Fighter, screw it. You're sleepy, what about you, dear? I'm trying a new thing, Kuni, with... I'm streaming my entire... I decided I'm gonna stream my entire work days in the form of IRL streams, so I just started doing that, like, last week. I'm pretty stoked I'm doing it, because it's combining my two passions, which is streaming and coding. Before, I used to do them separately, like I would stop my stream and then I would code. But then it would get really lonely, right? Like I'd be coding all by myself and I wouldn't have anyone to talk to. But now at least some peeps might pop in during my IRL stream and at least say hi, and that makes it worthwhile. So my point of view is, like, why not stream? The only difference between streaming and not streaming for me is pushing that broadcast button. So it's easy enough to do that while I work. So, spent a lot of headache today, guys, trying to get Node.js, which is JavaScript. It's the server-side version of JavaScript, so if you ever want Java code running on the server, and that's exactly what we want. We want our chatbot, our Twitch chatbot, we want it to be running on a server, because we don't want to worry about having a PC open and having the application open on your PC desktop. We just want it to be on the cloud, out of our way, running all the time, 24/7. So we don't have to worry that if our power goes out on our PC, the chatbot would go down also. If you run it in the cloud, that kind of stuff is kind of mitigated. So, yeah. Ryu rank. I'm changing my Twitch channel. With Twitch's okayest Ryu. Change the game title. All I hear is gibberish. I don't know anything about coding. I'm glad it makes you happy though. thanks for that, Kuni. I appreciate it. Yeah. All the dorky things make me stoked. I don't know what game I want to play. If I want to play Street Fighter or something else. I'll play Street Fighter. Thank you. I'm gonna just quick heads up, guys. I'm gonna stop and restart the stream just so it's a separate vodcast recording, a VOD recording. So hang in there. You might have to refresh. Apologies if you have to. All right, be right back. Restarting stream.